Hi guys, what's up? And you would have noticed that I'm talking in English because this video is going to be in English. Surprise, surprise. So I just wanted to make a very small video about a few beginner portrait photography tips which you would like to use and also to learn. And this in the background is obviously me, a photo taken by one of my friends in a construction site. So yeah, it looks dark and epic, right? Moody. Cool. So let's go ahead with the tips. Make them laugh. You have to make people laugh, so that's when the kindred spirit gets revealed in the photo. So if you see in the left, this is my friend which you've already seen in the other video. I was taking photos of him. He was posing seriously like those constipated females on cover magazines. So I just told him, or should I say recited a clean joke which he told me 5 years back. So he just laughed so much about that clean joke, you know, it's so epic, and that made for a good, great photograph. And same thing happened here. This guy is another friend of mine who too I had to crack a little bit of joke to get him going, and he smiled, and it, you know, when he smiled, he turned his head a bit, and you can see the spotlight actually gleaming from his eye, in his left eye, and the other flashlight from the bottom hitting his left hand side of the face. So if you edit this photo, you can actually end up with a Brandon Waffle type of result. So this happened because he laughed. So number one, do make the people laugh, because it really makes their kindred spirit pop up. Number two, it breaks the ice between you and your client, and you can really start getting comfortable with your client just for the sake of photos and not for anything else. Next point. And this too is such a photo taken in which I cracked a joke about the one of my friends here. He was a soon-to-be father. He is a father now of a beautiful girl. So I was just joking about something, and she and his wife couldn't stop laughing, and it made for a great shot. It wasn't planned, but that's how great things happen in life, you know, the unplanned ones. It's high time I stop being poetic. Next, environmental portraits. So this you see here is my grandmother. So environmental portraits are not just zoomed out photos, okay? Environmental portraits are portraits which, you know, show a person in their daily, you know, habitat. Jeshuran, you're talking about humans, not animals, not habitat. Or should I say, because of their habit, the place in which you find them do what they do. So over here, this is my grandma. She reads the Bible. You see a Bible over there, as well as read the newspaper in this place of the house. Such a good place she has chosen, you know, I mean, the light just beams on her face from the window, and she wouldn't understand that anyway. By coincidence, it's a great shot. Sorry, I'm being narcissistic. It's a great location, and environmental portraits do reveal more about a person. And this is one of my friends from college, and this guy is really passionate about doing projects and building cars from steel rods, and also he was the only engineer in our batch. Others just did it for the sake of doing it and to earn money in the future or to jump to an MBA, maybe. So yeah, so this guy is into making cars. So where do I take a photo of him? In the mechanical workshop. Doing what? Holding what's that equipment's name? I don't know, they use it for mild grinding maybe. So mild grinding cutter or something. So that's what he was having in his hand. You see, that's what happens when you chill with the camera, you don't know what you're studying about. So environmental portraits are important because they reveal more about a person, and you have to shoot it at a place where you really find themselves. Okay, so even if you have to arrange for it before, go ahead and do it. It'll look really good than just a normal mug shot. Go high with kids. That didn't turn up good. Not literally, but still, when you're taking photos of kids, you should raise the camera up above the eye level and go vertically upward, you know, and shoot it from downward. So this shot, like, is one of my friend's nephews, and we do this actually while taking photos of little kids, because, you know, when they look up, it's their innocence which is radiated from their gleaming eyes. So whenever they look up, you know, it's like they have that innocent, beautiful smile, and the natural light source above in the ceiling or in the sky will actually produce a gleaming in their eyes. So that's really good while taking child portraits, and if you're a beginner at it, do try this. Go high with kids. Not literally. So that's how you go about with kid portraits a small little dip. And next, use foreground elements. I cannot stress this much. So it is from another shot from the same maternity shoot, and it is another shot from the same profile photo shoot which I had. So in the first case, I used a prism. So when you rotate the prism, you can see that it reflects from different angles the light source which fall on it. So one particular angle, the trees on the left hand side behind me are the ones you see in this photo in the bottom right. So the prism actually reflects from what's behind me in front of me, and that makes for a great artistic photo. So, and on the left hand side, this is I pulled two branches of a plant together and shot it through a tone gap in the leaf. So that's how you can add more interest. So when you see the left photo, instead of just taking an Instagram mugshot, it's more looks like he is going to star in the next edition of Katy Perry's Roar. So that's how you mess about it, using foreground elements. You can also use a knife, a normal glass, a little bit of sprinkled water, and shoot straight into the sun, take a silhouette and all. So all these, so the lens blurs actually form a foreground, technical foreground element. So these things add more story to the picture instead of just taking a normal shot, you know. Now you may want to stare at these photos for a longer period of time. So hence, do use foreground elements. And yeah, this another such shot in which I was lying on the ground to take a photo of this elephant rising up from the water, and this was shot through few bushes. So it gives a more mystical and more beautiful shot, you know, than just an elephant just rising from the river. You know, any guy from Kerala can take such a photo, but this is more like a secular elephant rising from a Tamil Nadu river with a blurred fore background. You know, it's more epic. So that's how it is. Nothing against Malus though. Seriously, nothing against them. And next up is mess up the scale. Now I did talk about environmental portraits. Now this is just taking it to a whole other level. So in which you zoom out a lot or you walk back a bit more, in which the subject actually gets reduced to too small a size or too big a size. If it's kids, do make sure that they look big. Adhikini, you don't have to go and make them stand next to the tower of Eiffel and, you know, act like it's they are touching the top. No, that's not necessary, just in normal activities. And if you're shooting an adult, do make them look small. Now this shot in Mudumalai, in the middle of the jungle, so obviously the trees here are of giant size. So what you see is just the middle height of the tree. So it goes on for more feet above and more feet below the frame. Okay, these trees are really huge. So I went back, stepped back a bit, zoomed out and took the shot of my dad, who is precariously sitting on a small fence about, I don't know, he can lose his balance anytime, you know. I don't know. Am I a good son? Instead of just warning him, taking a photo of him, I don't know. And this is such another shot taken in the pathway, just close by to area where the trees are huge, and you can play about perspectives and scales of reference when it comes to vision. So that's how you do it. Zoom in very. And next up, backgrounds are really important. Of course, we do not pay importance to backgrounds. We just say, hey, photo is a seagram, mama kalambaran. Oh, photo is a seagram, you know, kalambaran. But backgrounds are important. You know, I really get pissed off whenever there's a wire or, some other stranger, a third person in the background. So that's really important. Even directors know backgrounds are important. Because backgrounds can, number one, emphasize the foreground. Number two, contradict the foreground. Or number three, add more contrast and more story, more visual interest to the foreground. These 3 points they are backgrounds are used to do. If you see this frame from Zack Snyder's Man of Steel, you'll see Jesus contemplating his sacrifice in the background, and you'll see Superman contemplating his sacrifice in the foreground. So the background over here just emphasizes a story in the foreground. So backgrounds are important. And another shot from How to Train Your Dragon 2, you see the two alphas in the back fighting, and front you see two alphas. Both of them are chief creatures and they are fighting, and it adds more, you know, depth, more intensity to the frame instead of just seeing two people fight. So, and you can also contradict the foreground as well. There will be one shot from Mr. Bean, the movie, which if I would add in this video, I'd be judged big time by my close religious circle. So this frame is from where the David and his wife are like outside the hospital room, and they're worried about their daughter, and Bean is trying to revive the daughter inside, and what he does with the thermal shocks for a few seconds actually looks like something else. So the shot would be like these two in the front who are worried, and there's a goofy thing happening in the background. So it gives more contrast to the frame of composition, and it heightens the comic effect. So you can use emphasis for an intense or serious subject, and you can use contrast for a bit more comic subject. And number three is balance. You can use the background, I know, as for a sense of balance. And number four, do take care there are no extra subjects like unnecessary telephone poles or people walking around. So next two shots over here, this is an accidental shot which I took of myself. It's a selfie in a mirror. So you would see there's a bit of balance to this photo, this one on the left. So you see yellow on the left and a fade of burgundy on the right. And you see an element on the left with the wire going downwards and an element on the right with the wire going upwards. So of course, they are not very aesthetic. They are not fur coats hanging in a wardrobe, nor are they some beautiful women in the background. But still, it tells a story, you know, it makes you want to look at me in the center. Wait, does it really? I don't know. But I really love the background here more than the foreground. I hope you do too. And over here in the next frame, we have my friend here who's like leaning on a tree. And for this shot, I had to like really bend down, you know, turn this side, turn that side, lean in, lean out to see where I could cut two telephone poles from the street nearby the park. Because it would be really awkward to have two telephone poles in the background. Do take care of them. Unnecessary subjects, get them out. So next, using mobile phone torches for cheap, good-looking shots. Of course, they will not be really great, but it'll look good. So these are such shots taken of like two of my other friends. So there's this spotlight which I have in my house, okay, installed right before my birth. I don't know why, but now I know the purpose. Predestination. The spotlight was predestined to be used for me. Wow. Okay, so the spotlight here is directed straight on their faces, and behind, below them, behind and below them, towards their left, towards your left, there would be a mobile torch, and in front of them, towards the right, there is a reflective mirror. So what the layout would be like this. So that square thing is the mobile torch. The arrow from above is the spotlight. And this deflected arrow is the reflection. So it gives a pale highlight towards the right hand side of the face, a strong highlight towards the left hand side, and from behind it gives a good rim or even a profile lighting towards the left. So that's what you see here in these two shots. You get strong yellow lighting towards the right, a little bit of exposure on the right, and on the left you see these a rim in this in this profile. So that's how this can be used or manipulated. It's a very easy way. You can try it out to learn about, you know, layout of lighting before you get professional. And this point is relative motion. Now if you get killed trying this, please don't blame on me. So yeah, if there is relative motion, blame me, grammar Nazis. I said blame me. So relative motion. So when the foreground is stationary and the background is moving, or the foreground is moving and the background is stationary, so that it gives a bit more animation to the photo. You know, you can sense that he is in a hurry or it's in movement. So this shot of my friend, we took it inside an MRTS station, I mean train. So this was the train was about to stop, and that's when I could get a few, you know, subjects in the frame. Because I was sitting low, I had to wait till it approaches the station at a lower shutter speed, and boom! This is how it looks. It adds more depth to the story and it looks good. But please don't ride sitting on a bike and taking a photo of another friend on another bike, and don't get killed. Okay, don't get killed. Be wise when you do this. Use public transport for this. Don't ride this on bikes. And next one, use the window not to kill yourself, but to take good highlighted portraits. So this is one shot of my classmate from 2 years. A shot is 2 years ago. So the light from outside the window was really good and mild one afternoon. It's a cloudy afternoon and it cast a very gentle shadow. So I really liked the photo, the way it turned out, and I just straight away imported it into Lightroom. After 2 years though, he kept begging me for 2 years, and the photo came out well. So these are the 9 tips for beginners, like make them laugh, environmental portraits, use the window, shoot using mobile torches. Backgrounds are important, mess up the scale, use foreground elements, go high with kids and relative motion. So do try these out and see if it works out. And yeah, I guess I'll wrap this up. Thank you and goodbye.